In this video, we'll talk about openEHR in the context of other health IT standards. And the elephant in the room is HL7 FHIR. FHIR has become very popular these days, with most government bodies implementing some sort of standardization based on FHIR, usually R4. And FHIR, while it started out as a messaging standard by HL7, has now changed into something that it didn't start out to be, and which is, it has also turned into a storage format. So the reason being simple, because people didn't want to map from their own data system into FHIR. So they started using FHIR resources as a means of storing data as well. Now, this is a direct competitor to what openEHR is doing, in which case it's just storing data in a clinical data repository, which is vendor neutral. FHIR is technically also doing the same thing, which is storing the resource in a vendor neutral data repository. And you may ask, why should I use openEHR and how does it differ from FHIR? Why can't I store all my clinical information in FHIR? Now, to answer that, we need to understand exactly how FHIR came to be and how its nuances. So if you take a look at, HL7 FHIR, right? So the way they model resources is that there is just a resource. So you have an observation resource, you have a condition resource, you have all of these different resources, but they only have one level of modeling, which is a resource. Now, there are other ways you can capture these resources. There are other profiles that you can go for, but the main principle behind FHIR being, we will define these resources based on the requirements of 80% of the people who want to exchange data. And that again is called the 80-20 rule in the FHIR world also. So they have 145 resources which follow this 80-20 rule, meaning if you alone are capturing a certain data point in your hospital or in your setting, and you want to publish that to the FHIR resource, you can't do it unless 80% of other people also capture that data point. Now, this becomes a problem really quick, as you will see, because most people want to capture these data points anyway, and they end up having extensions, and they end up going with extensions that are able to capture these data points. And on top of that, FHIR, since it only handles the 80% of the use case, and it just has these 20% of the data points, the remaining task of modeling is left to the implementers. So what that means is, people have to profile a FHIR resource, or they have to profile FHIR using an implementation guide before this can be used in real life. So for example, the US has the US core FHIR profile. India has the Indian NRCS FHIR profile. So just like that, every country which is using FHIR has its own FHIR profile. Now, what happens is that the US FHIR profile is not compliant with the Indian FHIR profile, because they just, FHIR as a standard itself never said how to capture something as simple as blood pressure. So each of them invented their own version of how blood pressure should be captured. Now, this is what is happening today, and there is an explosion of these different profiles and different ways to capture information just even using the same FHIR standard. So just because two people are using FHIR doesn't mean that these FHIR resources will be interoperable. Now, coming to openEHR, they have the two-level modeling approach, which I think is very elegant. So they have archetypes, which are again maximal data sets, and they have 881 active archetypes as of today. And these are maximal data sets. So what that means is that people have gone through the pain of creating 881 maximal data points in the archetype designer. And all of these are mostly clinical driven. So if you think about HL7 FHIR, I think it's mostly driven by health IT people, and they have their requirements and they make these change requests. But again, it's only taken up if 80% of the people agree on, yes, we do need this. Whereas in openEHR, even if one or two hospitals are using it, if a clinician and if the governing body thinks that it is valid and it is a proper use case of that particular archetype, they will add that data point to that archetype. And it is maximal in that sense that almost all the data points that need to be captured in an archetype will be captured in that archetype. Now, what this allows us to do is have downstream artifacts like templates, where we can cancel out things in the archetype and then use it in your system. But even if somebody else is using this archetype, you are 100% interoperable with the other person using the archetype. So there are no concept of people creating profiles on OpenAIR or like extensions on OpenAIR. All of the changes are done on the archetype level, and that penetrates down into the downstream templates. So that, I think, is a very good approach to handle interoperability and the whole problem in general. Now, if you take a look at the FHIR website, right? So you also have these resources which are right now mature and normative, and these other resources which are in level 4 and level 3. Now, the other problem that I have with FHIR as a data standard itself is that these keep changing quite often. From R4, there will be R5 tomorrow, and there will be R6 and so on. And the way this change happens is usually there is a change request that you need to make. And again, if you look at the submit for proposal, right, you get taken to their Confluence website where there are hundreds of resources that are waiting to be approved and waiting to be moved into a normative version of FHIR, or even at least like a level 0 resource. But the problem is that there is not a proper method of governing how this happens. And for you to submit the proposal, you first need to go through a long process of submitting this, and then it just shows up here, and there is no proper governing body, which is primarily clinical, which then takes these resources from its infancy to maturity. And that is another main issue that I have. It's mostly driven by health IT people, and it's not yet, there is no proper governing here. The same thing, if I go to the clinical knowledge manager, I can upload my archetype right now. I can easily just click add resource, and I can browse, and I can upload an archetype today. And the whole thing grows through a very open process of reviews and feedback that happens out in the open. I get an email now and then asking me to review certain archetypes, and you go, you review them, and after a certain time frame is done, the review process closes, and then people make updates to the archetype. So I feel this is much more, it's much well governed. And as time goes by, I think the amount of new changes or new resources that have come out in FHIR is nothing compared to the amount of archetypes and contributors that are there on the CKM. So for example, if you take a look at the reports and if you take a look at the archetypes, there are 1,163 archetypes in total, out of which 282 are depreciated and they're rejected. The remaining 881 are still good archetypes. And if you see here, it has about 149 archetypes that are properly published, meaning they're at least version 1. So that still, it's a great feat, because OpenAIR doesn't cover any of the administrative stuff like FHIR does. This is just purely clinical resources, and they have these many. And if you take a look at the overall statistics, you can see the number of reviewers that are there, the number of translators that are there, people from all over the world contributing to these archetypes. So I think the community as a whole in OpenAIR is much more mature, and it has been around for a lot longer, and it's mostly driven by clinical requirements rather than the requirements of health IT professionals. So that, I think, is the main difference. So again, coming back to our slide. So the 80-20 rule, again, I think it's not the right way to go when it comes to having interoperability. People will invent the remaining 80% of the requirements through extensions, and you end up having multiple versions of FHIR which you have to map back and forth between. So that being said, the reality today is that OpenAIR does not exist in a void, and everybody else is not using OpenAIR. But you do have an advantage using OpenAIR in this case, because you can easily get adapters, and you can easily get other converters that can translate to and fro between these other standards. For example, FHIR in this case, it can be a messaging FHIR standard, or it can be a REST API. You can still make an OpenAIR system work with FHIR through the messaging paradigm. So you don't necessarily have to store data within your system in FHIR, which I think is a very bad idea, because the FHIR keeps changing. It's not, it doesn't really meet the requirements of clinical data capture. So again, so that's the main problem being with FHIR. And you have other standards also, like HL7, V2, CCDA, for example. And all of these are, again, your core data is still in OpenAIR, but you use these standards to communicate between other systems that are also in the world. Now, again, coming to other implementations like OpenEMR, there is a lot of confusion between OpenEMR and OpenEHR. So they are not the same. OpenEMR is a specific implementation of EMR in PHP. It just happens to be open source. And we also have OpenMRS. Again, OpenMRS is a medical record system, a specific implementation in Java. So OpenEHR is more of a standard on top of which you can build any application that you want. These are specific implementations that are confined within their own language. And if you have to make any changes to the architecture, you need to know PHP or Java, and you need to make plugins in the same languages. Now, that being said, OpenMRS is actually a mature system, and a lot of people around the world are using OpenMRS to record clinical data. And the interesting thing that I noticed about OpenMRS is that they have this concept of dictionaries, to record concepts like diagnosis, symptoms, or finding. And it is very similar. It's eerily similar to archetypes. And that's what I feel. If you are actually in the field and if you understand the requirements of the clinical community, I think it's not too crazy to think that two people will come up with the same solution to the same problem. And they also have dictionaries, and you are able to, this is OpenMRS that I'm talking about, and you are able to define something like archetypes in clinical concepts in the dictionaries. So that being said, you are expected to create your own dictionaries based on your requirements. So while this meets the need of local requirements of a local hospital, for example, it pales in comparison to the 881 archetypes that are already published and the clinical effort and work that has already gone in to OpenEHR. So if anything, I would say there is a lot of scope where OpenMRS dictionaries and concepts can be derived from these archetypes, and OpenMRS can become OpenEHR compliant as well eventually. But again, OpenMRS is just one implementation of an MRS system. It is very similar to OpenEHR in the sense that it has dictionaries, but it doesn't have things like templates where you can cancel out an archetype and then use that. It doesn't have AQL. It is still its own system, but the dictionary part of it is very interesting. So now next, coming to code systems like SNOMED CT, ICD-10, RxNorm, and loinc, most of the time you want to use this in parallel with OpenEHR. So when you're recording data in OpenEHR, OpenEHR provides the information model. It says, what are you capturing? And usually these code systems go into the data itself. So you, for example, something like, what is the chief complaint of the patient today? You want to record the answer as a SNOMED CT concept. And you want to record, for example, what lab test is this, the code of that as a loinc code. So that being said, there is also codings for the information model itself in OpenEHR. So for example, if you go to the CKM and if you look at the famous blood pressure archetype, you see that it has a SNOMED CT coding to the concept itself of blood pressure. And the same goes for each sub-concept here. For example, systolic, it has a SNOMED CT concept to the data model itself. So that way you can have information binding to SNOMED CT and you can do that. So this work has been done by the archetype designers. They have already put in this work to actually do it. But most of the time, I think you would be using SNOMED CT, loinc, RxNorm in conjunction with OpenEHR in order to either record information or annotate a particular node, saying that this node means this. And that's about it. I think that's how OpenEHR is related to other health IT concepts. So if I missed anything out, please do let me know. I would like some feedback. And if you do have some questions, do let me know. But I think that covers most of it. So thanks for watching, and bye.